Hi, welcome to Crosspoint Community Church. I'm Brandon.
And I'm Nathaniel. This is what you need to know this week.
If you're a first-time guest and you're wondering what we're all about, our mission here is to lead people to be passionate followers of Christ.
If you're wondering what those boxes were when you walked in, back there, that's Tom. Stands for tithes, offerings, and missions. And this is how we take offering here at Crosspoint.
Be sure to mark your calendars for December 16th, because right after the 10:45 service, we'll be having baptism. Be sure you're there, because it's a celebration you do not want to miss.
Don't forget to mark your calendars down for December 2nd. We'll be having our Christmas kids stuff. Come on out at 5:45, or you can come out at 6 o'clock. Don't miss it.
Students, there is no student takeover tonight due to the Thanksgiving holidays, so be sure spend the rest of your Sunday night with your families.
Well, today we continue our series, Make War, with part 2, Battle Plan.
That's all we got and need to know this week. If you have any questions, stop by the welcome table on your way out, or you can visit our website, crosspointonline.net, or you can check out our app. And see y'all next week.
Hey, everybody. You ready to start part 2, Satan interview? Waiting on the big guy to get here. Late as usual.
Coming! Sorry about that. Just got done with my weekly jazzercise with Hitler.
Yeah, sounds great.
It's, How'd that go? It was great as usual, you know. The guy can't keep up, but, you know, we can keep up with this.
Good movies lately?
You know, I just saw Crazy Stupid Love. Incredible.
Yeah?
I'll tell you what, Steve Carell, he's great.
Oh, have you been out to see that yet?
Oh my, you know who. Don't get me started on Argo. Ben Affleck. I cannot stand that guy. They tell you how much I'm getting paid to do this? A lot.
I discussed your love of sin, but how do you get people to sin?
You know, it's interesting you ask that, Daniel. One of the big things is that when people are trying not to sin, I mean, you've kind of got them. But let's say, for instance, you've got someone who's trying to stop watching pornography. Next thing you know, all they're thinking about is pornography. It's a lose-lose situation.
Or win-win.
Or, I mean, for me.
Here at the church, we have been discussing for several weeks about...
Is that a Bible you got there?
Yeah.
Do you mind if I take a look? Give me... Well, actually, hold on.
Seriously?
Thank you. Let's see. It's on my Kindle Fire. It's not as complicated. Here we go. Your eye is the lamp of your body. When your eyes are good, your whole body is also full of light. But when they are bad, your body is also full of darkness. That's great. I mean, you see, all I have to do is get them focused on the bad, and I win. Daniel, don't eat cookies. What are you thinking about now? Cookies, right? I mean, it's that easy. It really is. I don't do a lot. I mean, well, you know, when they first hit the scene, I was, what's that? Oh, sorry, I have to do this. Duh, for you or for her?
Modern time of your work?
You mean just not working towards sin? Just things that I've done?
Anything, yeah.
There's Spider-Man 3, the replacement refs in the NFL, every Will Smith album, but, I mean, hey, you can call those sin. I really like the part in there where I'm in the desert. It's my favorite part. That and the whale.
Yeah, and that's how Satan leads us to sin.
See you guys next time, and remember, don't forget Glee this week, Tuesday night at 8.
So, I'm not positive if it's a compliment or not to come up to Nathan and say, you make a really great Satan. I mean, my initial, just what I want to do is just, you're natural at it, you know? It just comes. Good morning, welcome to Crosspoint Community Church. My name is Bobby, I usually lead worship here, but today I am preaching for you. I said I wouldn't do it, but I'm going to say it again. I was back there as the worship band was practicing. I was trying to get ready, and I asked Daniel, our sound guy, where the mic was. And he was like, you're preaching? And I was like, yeah. He's like that? So I just want to take a little moment before I start preaching today to explain my style. These are my kicks. They are PF Flyers. You may have seen them in the movie Sandlot. Run faster, jump higher. I don't have to explain that they're cool. This is a cool thing. These are my jeans. I got them at PacSun. PacSun's a hip place. Express Men, that's the logo right there, where my track jacket comes from. Don't run track, it's just simply stylish. And this is my shirt. I don't know where I got it, but I got it on sale. I think it was Kmart. Maybe that's the one where I shouldn't say where I got it. Okay, so anyway, you can shop at Kmart. I'm not saying anything bad about Kmart. But anyway, I just want to say my style is okay. I'm very against what Daniel had to say about me. Anyway, sorry, moving on. Let's actually preach the gospel. Okay, so last week we talked about, if you were here, we talked about how sin is external. It's not of us necessarily, but it's of the world. That you may have heard in tradition before that sin is kind of part of the world or is part of Satan, and that's what the enemy is. But we learned last week that the real enemy is in ourselves. Now another thing we may have heard last week, and as we talk and as we go throughout this series, it's make war against our sin. And so when we realize that the enemy is ourselves, and you may be tracking along with that, you may have been from the tradition of the enemy is outside, or the enemy is something of the world. And then you realize last week that yes, it's me, I'm the problem, and I want to get rid of the sin in my life. And so what we're going to be talking about and what we talked about last week, what we try to get you pumped up about is combating that sin. And so today we're going to talk about just that, how we fight this sin. And so the first inclination we're going to have when we hear sermons like we did last week, when we've made the decision that we don't like the sin in our lives and we want to stop that and we want to follow Christ, the first thought is, okay, my goal is going to be not sinning. And today we're going to look at how maybe that's not the right way to approach it. And so if you have your Bibles, I want to invite you to Hebrews chapter 1, or chapter 12, verse 1. Sorry, I'm not going to start that early on. But it will be up here if you don't have your Bibles, and I'll go ahead and start. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, turn to your neighbor and say, you are a great cloud of witness. Sorry, I had no purpose for that. Like, I didn't know what to do with that part of the verse, so I just, okay, that's funny. Okay, so therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witness, and this is the important part. This is the important part. Starting off slow, we're gonna get it back, don't worry. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. Now, let me just stop there. Like, at that point, I'm in, right? Like, let's go. I'm all about it. As Kevin said last week, be aggressive, be aggressive. I mean, like, I want to quote that. That's him, you know? And so we get to this point where we want to make war against the sin in our lives. We're uncomfortable with it. It's a problem. We are uncomfortable with it. We don't want it to be a part of our life anymore. And so we wage war against it. And that part, it's just, we so easily get entangled with sin. So let's just leave it behind. And after that, let's race. Let's race the race that's marked out for us. And let's set off. Let's get things in gear. And I'm with that. And that's what your attitude should be. And then things kind of change. I mean, that's like the make war part. And then it says this in verse 2. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus. Now it was just saying, let us throw off the sin that so easily entangles. Let's run the race marked out for us. Come on, this sin, we're going to go fight it. I'm starting with the man in the mirror. I'm asking him to change my ways. No message could have been any clearer. If you want to make the world a better place, you got to look in yourself and make a change. I'm sorry. Every time in my prep, I got to this part and I was like, you have to make sin against yourself. I'm starting with me. I'm starting with the man in the mirror. Michael Jackson is a song for everything. Sorry. Okay, let's get back. But that language is different. I mean, make war against your sin, and so we're going to shed off the sin that so easily entangles. We're going to take it off, and we're going to run the race marked out for us. Yes, I'm in. Let's go. And then fix your eyes on Jesus. I want to say we don't think about it like that. I mean, fix your eyes on Jesus. That's not a rally cry. That's not a battle cry. That's not something that you heard in 300. I mean, that's something that along the way you're getting all carried up and you're getting all enthusiastic about. I want to make sin. I want to make war against the sin in my life. And then you hear exactly this through Scripture, and it says the big crescendo is fix your eyes on Christ. And that doesn't really seem to make a lot of sense. Now, the reason that this sermon is so important today is that a lot of the time whenever we make this decision and we take the position against our sin, like I said earlier, our goal becomes to not sin. And so, okay, so I'm not going to sin. My goal becomes, well, not sinning. That makes enough sense. And the goal is that I'm going to fight sin and I'm going to take the battle straight to it. And somehow, though, even though it's frustrating because even though we are so enthusiastic about putting death, the sin, in our lives, we can't help but fall. And we can't help but fall. I remember when I was a little kid, we would take a trip out to the sand dunes. Has anyone been to Michigan? I mentioned that I'm not, I don't know if sand dunes are exclusively for Michigan. I don't know if there are other sand dunes. Basically, all you need to know is that sand dunes are a huge mountain of sand. And so we would visit there, and it's just a beautiful place because you can kind of see the lake and you can kind of see Chicago. And me and my sister were kind of competitive when we were younger. Yeah, that's right, Madison, shooting out a story about you. Okay, so she's right there. You can talk to her after the service about this. It's just very much fun. So we climb up the sand dune, and we look around, and we decide we want to race. And so if any of you have ever ran down any kind of a slope at all, this is nothing like it. It's much more treacherous. This is sand, okay? You've not been in our shoes. Actually, we weren't wearing shoes. That's beside the point. So we start running down this hill, this huge mountain that is sand. And so Madison is very athletic. She ran track in high school. She's always been faster than me. A point could be made that I was the artsy type, and I got more laughter at that for service. All right, so we're running down the hill, and she's just, and I'll say this, pride was her enemy. As she's running down the hill, she just takes off in a mad sprint. And you realize, some of you who kind of have maybe ran down a mountain before, there's that moment where gravity kind of teaches you a lesson, that you're running so fast, but then you can't actually keep up with, you know, kind of how fast gravity is making you go. And Madison's just sprinting, and, you know, bless her heart, she just didn't really know much at the time. But she's running as fast as she can, and she realizes she gets to that moment. And I don't want to say falling, because that doesn't really do it justice. Falling, to me, is always kind of, you know, involved hang time. And you might get to a certain, like, point A, you're falling, and then point B, oh, crap, I'm falling. And point C, I said crap in church, but I'm falling. And then point D, I'm going to hit the ground now. And you have time to think. There was no moment in which Madison was realizing that she was falling. She didn't have that courtesy. So she's running, and point A is this, and point B is just on the ground as hard. And you just hear this thump. And that was the last thing that Madison ever heard. No, I'm just kidding. That's not how the story ends. It's a little happier than that. But no, she just flies down onto the ground, onto the sand, and just covered with sand. And I see it, and I'm kind of behind at first, and I start running, and I just run past, and I win. The whole thing was me. I did fall later. I think we have video footage if anybody wants to see my mother about that. But I fell too, but I did win, so that was the important part. But I want to suggest that sometimes in our Christian walk, as we're getting so excited about making war, and like Hebrews 12 says, throwing off the sin that so easily entangles, we get to this point where we can't help but fall down. It's like no matter how hard we try, no matter how hard we focus on not sinning, I'm going to be better than this time. We can't help but continue to fall down. And so the remedy to this, at least according to Hebrews chapter 12, is to fix your eyes on Jesus. It's almost like it's not about fighting at all. It's about trusting. It's about a relationship. And maybe things could be different, or maybe this video that I'm about to show can put that in perspective. So let's look at this video.
Funny how it seems, always in time, but never in line for dreams. Head over heels, went toe to toe. This is the sound of my soul. This is the sound. I bought a ticket to the world, but now I've come back again.
Dang it. I was supposed to go into something else. Okay, I'm sorry about that. That was pretty weird, right? But if we just focus, and maybe fixing our eyes on Jesus is the best way to combat sin. Too late have I loved you, O beauty so ancient and so new. Too late have I loved you. Behold, you were within me while I was outside. It was there that I sought you, a deformed creature rushed headlong upon these things of beauty which you have made. You were with me, but I was not with you. They kept me far from you, those fair things which, if they were not in you, would not exist at all. You have called to me and have cried out and have shattered my deafness. You have blazed forth with light and have shone upon me, and you have put my blindness to flight. You have sent forth fragrance, and I have drawn in my breath. I pant after you. I have tasted you, and I hunger and thirst after you. You have touched me, and I burned for your peace. I just want to say, that's not war language. That's not like fighting words. I burn for your peace. I've tasted you, and I hunger, and I thirst for you. I was outside you, but you were still with me. The words of St. Augustine, they're words of endearment. They're words of romance. They're words of love. There's this passage in 2 Timothy. And it's pretty interesting because it's this older guy named Paul. And Paul is writing this younger pastor who's just kind of starting out. His name is Timothy. And Timothy, and Paul's giving Timothy this instruction. He's giving him encouragement. He's giving him just kind of all these different things you need to know and live by as you start your ministry, as you start leading other people to Christ. And one of the first things that he says is not fighting words, not like this war thing. One of the first things that he says is stir your affections for Christ. He actually says it like this: fan into flame the gift of God. Fan into flame. Like these things that I've taught you, I've laid my hands on you, Timothy, like I've given you this to live by. Don't let it go out. And whenever we talk about love or romance or relationships, we always talk about sparks and flames. And Paul's reminding him in this moment, fan into flame the gift of God. Before you start out, before you do anything, this is pivotal. Fan into flame, stir your affections. And so it's very simple how we fight sin. We don't take the battle to sin. We don't rely on our own strength or our own merit. We don't make the goal not sinning. We fan into flame the gift of God. We begin to stir our affections for how good and how wonderful and how holy Christ is. And so for the next, 10 minutes or so, I want to do that. I just want to tell two stories. I just want to talk about how good God is. Let's pray. Father, fill this room. I am not capable to do this without you. Fill my heart. May I burn with passion over the things that you've taught me over the years. And may we all realize that there is no way to fight our sin, that we can't do it, but we need to rely on you. I pray that I can speak words that will burn our passion, that will light our flames, that will fan our fires into who you are and stir our affections. God, stir all of our affections today. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. There's this story that I just love. And it's a story about a Samaritan woman. There's this woman, and she is caught in adultery. And the religious leaders of that day, they come and they take her to Jesus because if you've been caught in adultery, you are to be stoned. Like, that was just the culture of that day. And so they bring her to Jesus and say, they try to trap Jesus. They say, hey, she's been caught in adultery. The law tells us to stone her. What are you going to do? And so Jesus, very wisely, very smart, says, those of you that have not sinned, you can throw a stone. And so obviously, all the leaders, it says in the text that the older take away, or the older leave first because they realize that they are sinful. So everyone lays down their stone. And then this pivotal moment happens between Jesus and the woman. And Jesus says, has anyone condemned you? And the woman looks around and she says, no. And Jesus says, well, neither do I. It's like in this moment, and you got to put yourself in the story. Like in the story, you're not Jesus. You're not any other character. You're not the Pharisees. You are the woman. You're the woman that has sinned against her husband. You have been adulterous. And so the illustration is that you are sinful. And we learned last week the wages of sin is death. And Jesus even goes to the point by saying, has anyone else condemned you? And what he said to the Pharisees is so important too. Because what he says is, I mean, if you have not sinned, you can cast the first stone. And so basically what Jesus does is he gives himself the authority to condemn. Because Jesus is perfect. I mean, Jesus has never sinned. And so Jesus has every right to throw the first stone. In your relationship with God, he has every right to throw the first stone. And yet, does anyone condemn you? No. Well, neither do I. God, instead of being a God of condemnation, is a God of love, is a God of grace. And that grace is so furious that he doesn't condemn you. He doesn't lead you to the death that we deserve. Instead, he brings us into this light and gives mercy and gives grace to us. He's a God of grace. There's this other story that I just love. I remember we were talking, yeah, I'll just tell a story. There's this father and there's these two sons. And the son, the younger son, comes to the father and he says, I want my inheritance. And so what that means in that day and in that culture is I wish you were dead. So essentially, that's what it means. And the father gives his son the inheritance. Now, in this illustration, God is the father is the God character. And so the son goes off and he spends everything. He spends all of the wealth and he just starts to just do it vigorously and it's just awful. And he spends it on prostitutes and he spends it on all these bad things until the point where he has no money. And he gets to the point where he's just poor and he doesn't have anything to eat. And the text says that he's actually eating with the pigs in order to eat. And he realizes he has to go back. He has to go back to his father because he's not going to be able to survive. He also realizes that he's not worthy of being called a son anymore. So he'll just go back to his father as a slave. And I remember when I was in youth group, I kind of heard this message for the first time and I was just very excited about it. We got back into our discussion groups and this one kid started talking the entire time about how, he was sinful and about how, he really felt like he was in that place that the younger son was in, that he didn't really deserve to be a part of God's family anymore. And I'm just sitting there and he's just speaking this on. And I'm just like, I think you've missed the entire point of the story. Because after the son comes back and says, I don't deserve to be called your son anymore, the father, the God character, comes in and he runs to his son. Like the text actually says, as the son is far off, the father runs to him. And that's a ridiculous thing to do in that day and age. And he clothes them with new robes and he gives them rings and he showers all this affection and all this love on them. And he's like, this is my son. And he claims that back. Like he actually gives that title back to him. And this kid's just sitting there and he's just like, I'm sinful and I don't think I deserve this. I want to sit back there and I just want to be right next to him and say, no, you are deserving of this because the Father runs to you. He sheds his affection on you. We have a God who sees us and says he was lost, but now he is found. He was dead, but now he is alive. And so, like, if you're there where that kid was, where you don't feel like you deserve God, like some of you are coming in and you've heard the sermons and you just want to fight. Like, you just want to fight your sin because you realize that you're not deserved, you're not deserving of being the son anymore. That you only deserve to be the slave. I just want to tell you, the text doesn't allow that. And if you think you're too far off, if you think you can't be loved by God anymore, it's just, Bobby, the things I've done, like the places I've been, the person that I've been in my life. God, this story doesn't allow that. Instead, God loves you, and God chases after you. He claims his sons, his daughters, and he drowns them with love and affection. He puts new rings on our fingers. He puts cloaks on us. God is just so crazy about you. It's like, and the time that I realized that, I think I was 11 or 12 when I first realized that God loved me. And like, I grew up in the church, but there was just this moment, I was at a junior high camp. I don't like to give a lot of credit to Bible camp, but I have to. It's just so strict. They make you memorize so many verses. It's awful. But verses that I love so much. Okay, so anyway. But I started taking this real seriously, and I started actually applying a relationship to Christ, and everything's different once you have a relationship with God. Because you realize the goal of not sinning isn't good enough. That all it does is build a faith that's revolved and oriented around yourself. That you keep on failing and you keep on falling, not because you're not committed, but because you're committed to yourself. And the text says, fix your eyes on Jesus. It doesn't say fix your eyes on your own problems. It doesn't say fan your affection, fan the flame into what you have going on in your life. It says fan your affection towards him who died on a cross for you. Just for the sake of being in a relationship. I think it was St. Francis who said that he knew, he was convinced that if he was the only person who had ever walked the earth, he knew that Jesus would still die for him. Are you honestly convinced of that? Do you know that when Jesus was hanging on a cross, that when he was giving his life, he had you in mind. He had me in mind. And this is, guys, the cross is the biggest example of how that relationship should endure. Of how the goal can't be just not sinning, but it can be more than that. That can be focused and totally oriented around a Christ, a God who's crazy about us. Let's go back to Hebrews 12, if you don't mind. Just want to read the rest for you. Therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles. And let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us. We do this not by fighting. We do this not by building a faith surrounded about what we can do, but we do this by fixing our eyes on Jesus. And listen to this, the author and perfecter. He was made perfect by what he did on the cross. The author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. And listen to this, this is so important. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinful men, so that what? So that you will not grow weary and lose heart. It's like as he preached this, he just had us in mind. Don't lose heart. Don't grow weary. Don't depend on yourselves to stop sinning. Isn't that exhausting? Depend, lean on the cross. Fan your affections for how good and how great is he is. He is enough. I was nervous about preaching second service because first service bombed. I'll just say that. But no, it was okay. Everyone was happy about it. But anyway, I wasn't feeling good about it. So I went back and I was just kind of praying. I was praying, God, I just need you to be with me. God, I need you to be with me. God, I need you to be with me. And I was just like, it just dawned on me, he's enough. Like, he's enough for how much I can not be good at something. He's enough. He's enough for the areas in my life that I'm not enough at. Like, that's why he died on a cross. That's why he was resurrected. He's enough. So I just want to plead with you. Don't grow weary. Don't lose heart. Stir your affection. Fan your flame into Christ. Let's pray. God, I know that you are good. I know that you are lovely. I just want to say, I, from the bottom of my heart, love you so much that you take a burden off of me in the sense that I don't have to be enough. I don't have to be strong enough to fight my sin. I don't have to wage war. Instead, I can trust in you. I can find my comfort. I can find my power. And I don't have to live a life completely consumed of sin, not by my own merit, but by what you have done. God, let's never forget that. That on a cross, on a wonderful cross, you showed us how much you love us. Because of that, we won't grow weary and we won't lose heart. We'll fight, but we will fight for you. And we'll fight to be closer to you.